want to give some time of your free time to be here. I will introduce myself to everybody. I'm Martine Greta. I'm the sales manager for SCUBAPRO for 21 years for the Benelux, so the Netherlands, Belgium, and Luxembourg. And I'm very, very pleased to announce you. You are David Rhea, and please tell a little bit more about yourself. I already know, Martina. But maybe the rest.
Thank you, Martina. It's an honor to be here. Thanks for inviting me. I'm David Rhea. I'm the Florida sales rep for SCUBAPRO. I actually live in Tennessee. I lived in Florida 18 years and handled the Caribbean for about five, South Florida, the Caribbean, then took over all of Florida in 2001. I'm coming on 24 years with SCUBAPRO, and or 25 years, excuse me. And I originally was subcontracted to design the TEK line back in the mid 90s. And then that led to getting a sales rep job. And now I'm an independent contractor for SCUBAPRO. So been with SCUBAPRO a long time, and I work with Reese and Rayma and some of the engineers on designing as well as testing the new products.
So we are in the business for a long time, business and also with SCUBAPRO for a very long time. This is good to hear. I'm very happy that you're here. When did you start diving, David?
Well, when I was very young, I just had an absolute addiction to the undersea world of Jacques Cousteau. I used to drive my parents crazy to get home early from church on Sunday night so that I could watch that show. And even before I think I could speak very well, my dad would ask what I wanted to do when I grew up. And I said I wanted to be a scuba diver because I couldn't really say diver very well. And so I knew at an early age that's what I was going to do. And my uncle had bought a full set of equipment from a sporting goods store called the Athletic House. And he had a tank and a double hose regulator and things like this, and had a houseboat up on the lake. And when I was 9 years old, I finally drove him crazy enough that he let me strap on the tank and go down by myself and take a dip net and try to catch fish. And from that day forward, I knew I was going to be a diver, and I continued to drive him crazy to take me with him every chance we could so I could use his gear.
Okay, that's great. And so somewhere in this period of time, you were captured by technical diving. So you started with the normal gear, and then you said, okay, I want to do deeper dives, longer dives. Can you explain this part?
Yes. It actually came by way of someone violating standards, and that is my open water instructor. When we did the class in Tennessee, we would quite often, especially in the wintertime, we would go to Florida where the water temperature is 21 C year round. So it's very, very warm, crystal clear. So in the wintertime, we would go do the certification dives down there. And he and I had become very good friends when I was taking the open water class from him. And he actually took me in a cave on my open water checkout dive, which is a very big no-no to do. And the cave was like the most mesmerizing thing I had ever experienced in my life. And I came to the surface and said, I will be a cave diver. And at the time, I worked really hard to become an instructor. So when I was 17, I went through my instructor course, waited to turn 18 so I could get my instructor certification, and I immediately started working towards teaching cave diving.
Okay, that's great. So when you became teacher, that was about 20 years ago.
Yeah, no, a little longer.
No, yeah, so. Tell. So can you explain to me why you like the technical part? Because I already guess that it's more detailed, it's more precise kind of diving, but can you explain why you like the tech diving so much?
Yeah, I mean, it's, I kind of relate it to a lot of other things that I do in life, riding motorcycles or before jumping out of planes or different things. It's a lot of it is just when you do sports that are more demanding as far as your skill set, I love that challenge. I love things that actually require me to be the best I can be, even though it's impossible to maintain perfection, which is actually cool because it gives you more desire to do more. So the combination of the skill set it takes to safely cave dive, and then really for me, it's the exploration. So getting into the exploration of the underwater caves where you're truly going where no one has ever been in history, unless they were dry at one time, like some of the Mexico caves. There may have been humans that have been in there before, but it's when you're going where no one's ever been, and the techniques and skills and equipment, and most important is the team that it takes to do that. It's amazing. It really is a different kind of feeling. And it's, you know, a lot of people look at it as being high risk. And, you know, I don't really think that. Again, I believe it's like motorcycle riding and other things I do. If you don't get complacent and if you use proper equipment, you or have a great team and you don't break the rules that you know or exceed your limits, then I think it's as safe as recreational diving. So that's the technical diving in general. I always say cave diving because I'm most passionate about that, but I usually do a shipwreck trip at least once a year or every other year, big shipwreck trip to Canada. So I love the wreck diving, but I'm not necessarily a big history buff as far as people in the history of wrecks, but I am crazy passionate about the cave exploration.
Yeah. So what you are mentioning, it's all related, all coming back to the gear you're using, the plan you are making, and stick to the plan and be very precise every time again, because this is, I think, the most important thing, being aware of what you're doing every time you're diving. So I have another question, because we would like to know the best dive you ever made. Okay. Could you tell us about that?
Yeah, that was probably the toughest question on the going for the interview. Was it's like, wow, I've had so many amazing dives, and again, a lot of it has to do with not only the memory of what happened, but the camaraderie of the great teammates that I was with. So, I guess if you looked at all of them, and it was really hard to narrow down, but in 2008. Friends of mine and guys that I still dive with to this day, Jerry Jablonski and Casey McKinley and I went into a cave called Turner Sink. And Turner was named after one of the founders of the Woodville Karst Plains Project, the exploration team that I've been on for 25 years. And this is just a little sinkhole back in the middle of the forest that generally has duckweed on it, meaning it has this little tiny flower that makes the whole surface extremely green. I mean, very, very vibrant green. And I had never been in this cave, and these guys hadn't been in it in years. And the downstream exploration had been something people had avoided because it's a very strong siphon, so it's sucking you into the cave. So you kind of get in this small pool, and then you drop through and go through this restricted area. By restricted, I mean it's this big, but it's much smaller than everything else. And you get inside, and it's a normal size passage for people that have dove Devil's Eye or Little River, anything, a normal size passage. So we went downstream, and we were loaded up with a lot of gear to do a long dive. And we went downstream, and there's a big pit where it drops off, and we found that the line was broken. So I patched the line, we went a little further, and it was the end of the line. That's the furthest our team had ever explored. So we continued on, and on that day, we dumped 1,800 meters, almost 1,900 meters of line on a single dive, and the cave just became massive. I mean, big enough you could truly fly two aircraft on top of each other through this passage. You couldn't see the floor to ceiling, couldn't see the right wall from the left wall, vice versa. It was the biggest passage I'd ever been in. And not only was it the most line that was ever laid, and of course it was a siphon, which there was a lot of, you know, kind of scary feelings for everybody about diving in this cave, because when you go downstream for 2 or 3 hours and then turn around and you're going upstream against all this flow that's sucking you into the cave, it's a little bit more challenging. We had planned for that and prepared for that. But this all led to what eventually became the biggest connection and traverse in the world, which was Wakulla Springs to Turner Springs. So finding this downstream passage was monumental for me, because that was the very first real dive that had been done in there that ultimately led to the connection.
Yeah, I can understand. It was an amazing dive, really. Yep. I am very visual, so I'm trying to visualize it, but I don't think I can really, but it looks and it sounds very good. So when you are diving, are you diving with a rebreather? Are you diving with a regulator? And what is your choice then? when and where?
Yeah, it's, I mean, I spend a lot of time using both. I still teach cave diving. We do a lot of recreational cave diving. I do a lot of photography for different people, including SCUBAPRO. And so I spend a lot of time on open circuit. And of course, everything since the 70s for me has been SCUBAPRO. So all my open circuit stuff is SCUBAPRO. But ironically, in our exploration, 99% of the time I'm on a rebreather. But the rebreather that I use, we still have double tanks on our back, and the rebreather fits in the middle. So I have a Mark 25 or a Mark 19 on the right, and a Mark 25 or a Mark 19 on the left. And then we run stage bottles. We don't breathe the gas that's on our back. It's all for redundancy or for safety. So we actually use stages to drive the rebreather. And the stage bottle has a hose that plugs into a switch block that runs the rebreather. But that's all done with a traditional SCUBAPRO open circuit regulator. So there is a first stage that hose connects to, but instead of being a second stage on the other end, it's a QC6. It's a plug-in that plugs to the rebreather. But we also have an open circuit second stage. So if you think about a traditional stage bottle or a deco bottle, you have a first stage, a pressure gauge, and a second stage. We have exactly the same thing plus one additional hose. So I, on any given dive, I'll still have 100% SCUBAPRO on me, and I don't have a tank on my body that's not got a SCUBAPRO regulator on it.
And it's quite some gear you're carrying with you then.
Yeah, right.
If we look at all the dives you've made, maybe this is also a very difficult question. What was the longest in diving time? I know from Reese and all and my colleagues, Raima, they're doing dives, but they said, yeah, but David, he's the one who is doing the longest and the most difficult one. So I would like to know.
Yeah, so now the areas that we're working in the Woodville Karst Plains, most of the time the dives are a minimum of 60 meters deep. And lots of the caves for years that we dove in were 90 meters deep. And so probably my longest dive was 5 hours at 90 meters. So 2.5 hours to go penetrate into the cave. We were doing a setup dive, a 17,000 foot setup dive. A fellow named Mark Singer and I were setting up for a big exploration. And at that point, the cave went to about 17,000 feet, but had ongoing passage. So we were setting up two other fellows, Casey and Jared, to explore further. And so that dive was over 20 hours. So we did our roughly 5 hours on the bottom, but then that turned into over 14 hours of decompression. So the decompression starts at about 80% of the ATAs, you know, and so it's every, you know, 10 feet, every 3 meters into the surface. We are fortunate that in Wakulla anyway, not in all of our caves, but in Wakulla, we were able to create a habitat. So it's kind of if you think about a big trough like cattle or livestock would drink out of, we have those upside down on the ceiling of the cavern with a floor in them, and we can actually climb up in there. We spend 3 hours in that, and we kind of do our 20-foot stop at 30 feet because we're in the dry, and that is, of course, breathing pure oxygen and switching to a much lower oxygen percentage every 15 or 20 minutes, depends on the exposure. So we spend 3 hours in there, then we come back out and still take a couple more hours to get to the surface. So that particular dive was over 20 hours. Most often our dives are between 5 and 8. That's very common, whether we're in Florida or Mexico. But back in those days, we were doing some really long exposures.
So this, yeah, for me, it's amazing. 20 hours, it's your max, but still 5 hours, I think it's amazing. And how do you prepare yourself, your gear for your dives you are doing? I think you have to do some preparation before you go and dive, I guess.
Yeah, so for sure, maintaining your regulators, maintaining your rebreather, all these things are paramount. Maintaining your dry suit, making sure you don't have any leaks in your dry suit. All of us on the team have suits that we only use for exploration. We use them nowhere else, and that way we don't take a chance on damaging a suit on a fun dive or a teaching dive that then our life depends on staying warm in that suit. So we recycle our undergarments quite often. So we get new, fresh undergarments that we make sure if we're going to do a really big dive, we kind of rotate and we'll get new stuff to make sure they have the most loft and they're warmest. We have heated vests. The rebreather itself is mechanical design. It's very simple. It's a semi-closed rebreather, but putting it together correctly. And then, of course, the most important thing with all diving, especially technical diving, is properly analyzing your gas prior to the dive, making sure the bottles are marked correctly, because you're going to do gas switches at different depths. Lots of times we use 5 or 6 different gases on a dive or more. So we need to make sure those bottles are labeled properly, they're analyzed properly, and, of course, that all the regulators are functioning properly, because we need these. Of course, we have guys that go in and put in caches of safeties, and we carry out caches of safety. So we have safety scooters, safety bottles in the water. We have support divers, safety divers. We have a lot of things that are going on. And then the other preparation is really more mental. I'm not kind of a guy that really sleeps a lot anyway. And the night before, it seems like no matter what, I can't really sleep. So when you need all that sleep and rest to go dive, I always tend to have trouble with that because I can't shut my brain off. But you need to be, number one, you need to have fitness. If you're not fit, you're going to pay for it because it's a lot of gear. It's a long time to be spent, you know, perfectly in trim with your back arched and your neck back for hours and hours and hours. So being physically fit is also going to help you with your decompression, off-gassing, and being very hydrated. So pretty much the week leading up to the dive, you watch what you eat, you watch what you drink, you try to make sure you're good and hydrated. And, of course, we have P valves, and we will eat during the dive. So we've got gels that we can take, and then when we get in the habitat, we have food tubes. So in there, we kind of chow down on whatever we've brought with us. And we put camelbacks on the stage bottles. So on that particular dive, I think I drank 400 ounces, so 4 camelbacks full of water and liquids during the dive. So we can just stop and take the rebreather out and drink out of the camelback, put it mouthpiece back in so we keep ourselves hydrated. But mentally, you just need to be knowing that you're doing things right, taking care of your gear, your team's ready. And then we have a policy, you know, if you need to do this before the dive, not know that you've got an issue and go ahead and start the dive. Have the confidence to tell your teammates, hey, mentally, physically, I'm not ready, and thumb it on the surface. Don't wait until we have all these people involved and get underwater and then decide, hey, I shouldn't be here. So you need to know you're ready to go.
Yeah, exactly. So it's quite a preparation, but you are always very, very on top of everything. And safety is first. And this is what we discussed with Reese this morning. Safety is also the main issue for SCUBAPRO every time, every year, all the time. So I have 2 more questions, but maybe these are the longest ones. I'm sorry.
I'll try to shorten my answer.
No, you don't. I think people like it. So questions also in the chat box. So if people want to add some questions in the chat box, they can. We will look at it later. Maybe you have some tips, not just for technical, but also recreational divers. I want to put one, just have fun, but maybe you can put some other tips too.
First, I would say that, it's kind of funny. People learn to fly an airplane, or they learn to fly it, or drive a tractor trailer, or, you know, they're a doctor or whatever. And it's quite interesting that in scuba, you really don't have to renew. In other words, our cards are kind of good forever. I'm involved with a training agency called Global Underwater Explorers, and one of our first things we did is we make our cards expire. If you don't stay active as a diver, your cards expire, and that's just kind of a mindset I've always had. So my first thing would say to always seek out the best training you can get, because if you decide you're happy with a card that never expires, regardless of how much experience you maintain, then you want to make sure you got really good training to start with. Number two, I would say that regardless of the agency and regardless of how good or not your training was, you need to stay active. That, you know, there's no substitute with anything in life. You're going to get rusty. You're going to make mistakes, but those mistakes will be greater if you go a really long time between diving. Diving's the greatest sport in the world. It absolutely is. There's, you know, and sometimes the visibility's not great and sometimes the sea conditions aren't great, but hey, that's part of it. That makes you a better diver, that makes you a stronger diver. So stay active, dive as much as you possibly can, and of course, always pursue the best training quality you can get.
Yeah, I can totally agree with you. It doesn't even matter where you are in the world. It's nice here in the Netherlands as it is in Florida or Bali, Indonesia, South Africa, Norway. We can dive everywhere we want. So even in this difficult time, we are still very privileged to go and dive. So I think this is also very important to keep notice of, being positive and stay diving as well, what you said. So you are a SCUBAPRO ambassador for quite some time. And I would like to know what kind of gear, which gear you are, what's your most favorite piece?
It's hard to say because I have so much of it and I love it so much. We jokingly say I don't plan on being in a casket when I die, but we always say, you know, that's one of the things that would go with me if I was in a casket would be my frameless mask, because I've been using a frameless mask since we came out with it. Matter of fact, I'd probably have me wearing it. But it's, you know, the frameless mask has just been such an amazing part of my diving. You know, if you look at your mask as being the window to the underwater world, I have had the blessing of seeing so much amazing things underwater in the caves and the wrecks and in the sea everywhere. I've laughed so hard underwater that my mask was flooding like crazy. So I've had some of the best times underwater, and that's kind of been my window to that underwater world. So I love my frameless mask. SCUBAPRO's masks are awesome. The D mask is amazing. We have so many, the Zoom mask, we have so many masks that have been great. And we've had some phenomenal masks over the years that have slowly been discontinued. But the frameless is, I'm very passionate about it. I personally have 57 SCUBAPRO regulators, and they're almost all Mark 25 G260s or G250s. I helped work on the G250V years ago, so I'm very passionate about the Mark 25, and I'm very passionate about the G250, G260 now. I think the new Black TEK Mark 19 G260 carbon is, in my opinion, the most beautiful regulator we've ever made. And as a guy who's spent a lifetime using Mark 25s and Mark 10s, Mark 15s, Mark 10s, Mark 5s, I'm a very passionate piston person, but testing the Mark 19s over the last couple of years, diving the Mark 19 carbons right now, now that they have the turret and the fifth port, it would be, if I was just starting out as a SCUBAPRO diver, I would have a hard time deciding which one of those two I want to get, because they're equally just incredible regulators. So regulators, my mask, and of course I love all the other stuff too, but those two guys, especially with what I do, the regulators are really paramount and the mask is really paramount for the exposures that we're doing. And of course we have some stuff coming out later this year that I'm incredibly passionate about and personally devoted to, but we'll talk about that maybe if I get invited back sometime.
I wish I can invite you every time if you want, you. Please, and also live next time maybe. I just want to refer back to your Mark 19 comment, because I have it here. It's maybe a little bit difficult to show, but it's the G260 carbon with the Mark 19. It's a bit difficult, I think, to show on the screen. But I really, I have to emphasize, this is a very, very good combination of the Mark 19 development. And it's such a small regulator for a stage now compared to the one we had 15 years ago. Yes. And it has amazing features and benefits. And so I think this is the best choice now for everybody in the, especially the tech business, to have the Mark 19 with a G260. It can be the metal one or the black tech one. That's up to everybody, but I think this technical invention is the best choice.
And it's funny, I'm getting a lot of questions about right now, where would you go for technical diving? I just answered some yesterday. would you go Mach 19 or Mach 25? You can't go wrong with either one, but I can say one of the things that has always, or the thing that has really always made the Mach 25 a superior technical diving regulator was that five port turret. So being able to position the regulator, especially with doubles, because, you know, the Mach 25 position so lovely, being in like a V behind your head and being able to use those imports to route hoses. Now that you can do that with the Mach 19 and having the regulator completely sealed for diving and exploration, where you may have rust from the ceiling or percolation from the cave, and then, of course, the cold water that you guys dive in, I think it's absolutely the prominent regulator in the world for technical diving right now would be that Mach 19 combination with like the G260 or any of our second stages. Our second stages are all good. Just the larger size makes it easy with gloves and things of this nature to be able to enjoy and appreciate the the G260, plus the ability to reverse it, because a lot of people are doing side mount.
You can reverse the hose to the other side. Yeah. And the Mach 25 has the highest flow, the highest airflow, but in some circumstances you don't need the highest flow. And I think now in the colder areas, the Mach 19 with a turret, with the G260, it's the best combination for the tech. So I totally agree with you.
So and the black tech is beautiful.
Oh, I love
very tech looking.
Yeah. But in the chrome, it's also very nice. But in the black tech with the carbon, it's amazing. So yes. I put a small video on YouTube a couple of days ago, and I can show a little bit better the features and on this Teams meeting, it's a little bit more difficult. I think we have some questions. So if you have a little bit time, I will have a look. There is one person, he's asking what type of rebreather you are using.
So we use the RB80. So the RB80 was originally designed by Reinhard Bucali. He is a German fellow and designed it. It was called the RB2000. There's a cave exploration group, or used to be a cave exploration group, called the EKPP, the European Karst Plains Project, that's emulated what we were doing in Florida. And so the RB80 has been our choice rebreather. I've been teaching this rebreather for many, many years. And it's, like I say, it's not a electronic closed circuit. It's a semi-closed. So it's very mechanical in its design. It's very simplistic in its design. And basically the way it works is just like whatever gas you stick in your mouth, whether it's oxygen, nitrox 50, 1845, whatever's in that bottle that you put in your mouth, this is the way the RB80 works. As I mentioned earlier, it has a hose, and when you plug that into the switch block, you need to have verified the depth that you're at and the mix that's in the bottle. And that, of course, the hose, if you have multiple bottles, the hose is attached to the bottle you think it is when you plug it into your rebreather. But it's identical to the way we teach open circuit. But instead of putting a second stage in your mouth, you're plugging it into a switch block. It runs it through the rebreather. So from a training standpoint, pretty much everything you've learned up to this point, open circuit, to get ready to do the RB80, it's already prepared you in the right way. There's not an extreme change. And of course, we don't use any electronic controls. So what I plug in is what I breathe versus something that's mixing in the unit, like a typical closed circuit breather.
Yeah, I think this is a very complete and precise answer. I have another question from Han, and he's telling me, I'm not the real technical diver, but when you are working with, I guess, a rebreather, do you have a second or third double reserve of the air? Can you help others when you have when they have a problem?
Gotcha. Yeah, it was cutting out for just a second, but if I think I understood correctly, so if you can imagine we have a set of double tanks on our back for regular open circuit diving. And in that set of double tanks, we put a first stage on the right, and it has its own second stage, usually attached to a 7-foot hose. That way you can donate. And then you have the other regulator is going to have, or the other tank's going to have a first stage and a second stage. So you basically take what you'd have in open water and you divide it amongst two first stages. That way, if you had a problem with the regulator, if you blew a hose, if you had some type of seep problem or a free flow, instead of just losing gas, you could reach up and shut off that knob. Anything going into the regulator, anything from the first stage downstream, would no longer be leaking. So we isolate these by having the first stages independent. When we put the rebreather in between, we have the exact same configuration, but we add a hose that goes from the first stage to the mouthpiece of the rebreather. And in the bottom, we have a BOV, or what's called a bailout valve. By the way, in the RB80, all of the regular, all the BOV and the injectors are all SCUBAPRO parts. So it is a SCUBAPRO R190 basically sitting here at the mouthpiece, and you can flip a switch. This is would be in line with the hoses coming in to breathe the rebreather. You can turn it vertical and you're now breathing an open circuit R190. So we just add a hose to the normal configuration, and I can go to open circuit. I can remove the rebreather loop, and then I still have my 7-foot hose. I unclip it, I hand it to you, I come back on the loop, and then of course I would go back on the rebreather because it's going to be 8 to 10 times the gas mileage, or in other words, more efficient. But I can give you that long hose and you can breathe off those doubles. As I mentioned earlier, we don't breathe off the doubles normally, other than just temporarily if we're doing a gas switch or something, we need to go to open circuit. But we always drive the rebreather with the stage bottles. That way we have all of that redundant back gas, just in case we did have to share gas. If we gave somebody that long hose, we would have full double 18s or double 20s or whatever we have on our back for them to be able to breathe till we could get them to the next cache of bottles.
Right. Yeah. I think this totally answers a question. And I'm looking now. I think we are done with the questions now from the visitors. Maybe they have some questions and they can fill them in on scubapro.eu, and they come to us. And if there's something very specific, I will send it to you for sure, of course. Okay. Is there something you want to add, or you want to ask me or anybody else online? I don't know. Maybe you want to add something. It was not in the questionnaire.
No, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, again, thank you for inviting me. It's an honor. I truly am as passionate about working for SCUBAPRO and trying to educate people about SCUBAPRO as I was when I came on board all these years ago. Same way with cave diving. I'm very passionate about cave diving. I'm very passionate about technical diving, and I'm very passionate about teaching it, meaning my whole life has been diving. I've really not done anything else since I graduated high school but scuba. So, and when, you know, there's no greater thing in life than to find what you love and be able to figure out how to make money at it and how to make a living at it. And I've been very blessed to make a living. But most important of all this is the people that I've met. You know, the diving has been fantastic, but, you know, people that I know in SCUBAPRO, people that I know like JP and Anne-Marie and people all over the world. I've been blessed to travel all over the world, to explore all over the world. And I've truly met the finest people on earth because of diving and SCUBAPRO.
Yeah. That's I totally agree with you. And yeah, we are in the business a long time all together, and it's a great company to work for. And I'm very honored to be there, but I'm very honored to have our dive show. Maybe I can invite you to come to the Netherlands next year when we have a live show. Can I ask you that?
Absolutely. I would be honored. I would love to come. It's been a long time. I would love to come back.
I asked it to Reese this morning as well. I can see Reese is online too. Maybe you can just join with this camera if he's there. And then we can make a, yeah, he's there. Oh no. Anna-Marie is there. Yeah. And I can see, yeah. So it would be great if we have a live meeting, live show next year. And I'm very, very happy that your contribution to this live show this year. It's a little bit different from all the years we did, but I think it's still contribution. We put this on YouTube and on Facebook, and everybody who's having questions afterwards, they can ask us everything they want. Excellent. So from me here in Vinkeveen, very close to JP and Annemarie, very close. I can almost see them. And to you in Tennessee, I give you a big kiss. Ah, JP is there. So thank you very much. And yeah, hope to see you soon.
Thank you. Hi, JP and Annemarie.
Thank you.
Honor to be here. Everybody just dive. Forget about thank COVID you. And just go dive.
Yes. Yeah, that's the best tip. Bye-bye.
Right. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.